Okay, it looks like OPEC Plus has agreed to an additional 1 million barrels per day of extra supply cuts. This is on top of what Saudi will be shouldering. The price in crude, well, it's a little bit muted in terms of current reaction, but certainly there has been a lot of front-running going into this decision. Now crude's looking at $80 per barrel. Let's bring in Eric Nuttall, partner and senior portfolio manager at Ninepoint Partners. There was some anxiety. Is Saudi going to get the other members to corral? Are they going to be able to get other people to shoulder the burden of these supply cuts? It looks like they're going to.
Absolutely. And we have told people, do not doubt the will and intent of His Royal Highness Abdulaziz bin Salman, the Minister of Energy, Saudi Arabia, like the first royal to hold that position. I think everyone within OPEC knows that he wields the ultimate hammer, and they all have the same objective, which is to try to lower volatility in the price, try to eliminate the distortion from the biggest release in history from the SPR from the United States. And then finally, to get a more budget-friendly price, because many members within OPEC have a meaningfully higher fiscal break-even than the current oil price, including Saudi with Vision 2030, which is a very ambitious plan. So I think when you look at why are they cutting incremental production, much of what they were trying to achieve has been achieved. We have global inventories now at their lowest levels since 2017. Despite the fear-mongering of recessions, demand is pretty much close to an all-time high now, up about 2.4 million barrels per day. But it's more about how we've arrived to where we are. I wouldn't have thought that they would need to curtail incremental volumes 6 months ago. So my tagline we've been running, the battle cries, we remain bullish. And I remain bullish, but not as much as earlier this year, because there's been a few surprises. One of which is U.S. supply has grown more than we thought. We thought it'd be up about 500,000 barrels per day. It's up 800. Now, you have to understand, well, why is that? A really important data point I learned yesterday from an analyst from Raymond James is that two-thirds of the volume growth is coming from private operators. Why that's important is we've seen a series of M&As, a lot of private selling themselves, and they're financially motivated to goose production to make it accretive to the buyers. So that big wave is no more going into next year. We did not expect the White House to turn a blind eye to enforcing sanctions with Iran, with exports up as much as 800,000 barrels per day. So supply's gone up more. The last little wrinkle has been refineries, which I'm still trying to wrap my mind around, because global product stocks globally are at a five-year low. Demand is very strong. Crack spreads, so the margin motivation to run crude is very high. And yet we're down about 700,000 barrels per day more than average. So I'm still trying to figure that out. Some people say, well, it's because the refiners ran so hard during days of high margins that there's more unintended downtime. So I'm still wrapping that up. So the market's a little looser than I would have thought. Still tight, but not as tight as we would have expected.
So this less bullish, I'm just trying to wrap my head around it, especially coming from you. What does that mean in terms of price?
So we would have thought we'd be at $100 by this time, 6 months ago. Clearly we are not. My thought is we're in a range-bound market, which I think is becoming a consensus view, roughly 80 floor, which I think OPEC is defending, 90 ceiling. I don't see the bull case of the next year to go much above $90 oil, given spare capacity and that Saudi and others are shouldering now. That will slowly come on as demand increases and matches that off.
So what does that mean for your energy holdings? Are you pulling back on your exposure?
No. So I'm glad you raised that, because that's the most important question. What do energy stocks look like? And not just oil stocks, but natural gas and service stocks, because we're looking at the whole spectrum of energy. When I look at oil companies, you can still find companies today at $80 oil, so roughly where we trade today, trading at 20% or higher free cash flow yields. So a Baytex, a Crescent Point, trading, you know, three times cash flow, 20% free cash flow yields.
You still like Crescent Point?
I do.
It was a kind of a sluggish, sloppy deal.
Yeah, I think we're their largest shareholder now. We went on 19 million shares. So that was.
And did you participate in that financing?
I couldn't, because it was 10%.
Okay.
We bought another million shares at $10.03 the day of the deal when the price came down.
For Crescent Point, yeah.
So what this means is we're in a range-bound market. The sector itself trades at 13% free cash flow yield, which is very attractive, but you can find better names. So it's a stock picker's market going forward, which excites me, because that's an area that, in my opinion, we excel at. You can also be bullish on other spectrums of the energy market. We just bought 9.9% of Precision Drilling over the past several weeks. We have that stock trading at a 34% free cash flow yield, rapidly deleveraging, approaching a point where they can pivot towards returning more free cash flow back to investors. And we've been the biggest bearers on natural gas for as long as I can remember. You can finally see line of sight to a bullish thesis in the second part of next year. And when you think about Canada, We'll have TMX online, we think, around March, give or take. So adding almost 600,000 barrels per day of new capacity, shrinking the differential for our oil. And the rumor is that LNG Canada is going to be coming on sooner than expected at some point in 2024. So the outlook for oil, while it's not as, you know, $150 shoot the lights out, it's still a wildly profitable price zone for companies. We're not in a demand-destructive window for the consumer. When I reflect on the sector, we still have the strongest balance sheets in history, massive amounts of free cash flow, companies reaching the point of inflecting to return more of it back to us, and names that I can buy at half of historical multiples. So, yeah, we're not as, like, the super, you know, super-duper bulls as we would have been earlier this year. You've got to adapt as the market changes and adapt to new information. But we still see a relatively tight market with multi-year low inventory levels and record demand.
So you're a top shareholder in Crescent Point. You're a very large shareholder in a company like Athabasca. You're probably now one of the top shareholders in Precision Drilling. So even though you're not bullish, you're at a position, well, all these companies should listen to their shareholders, but I know that they would listen to you. What are your discussions with management about how they should be proceeding going forward? You were very vocal a few years ago, buy back, you know, do all this stuff that are shareholder friendly, stop going out and doing acquisitions. Many of them found religion and started doing that. So now what are you saying to them?
It's the same conversation. The surest path to re-rating valuations is to pursue low to no growth, pursue deleveraging, get your balance sheet to where you want it to get, which we've been fine with. But when you get there, give us 75%, roughly speaking, of the free cash flow in the form of buybacks. Because in a market that is, it's been insanely volatile this year, energy funds have not been experiencing inflows. You know, it's myself and one competitor. I would expect to be the same. Sentiment is deplorable. You look at net length in WTI, it's at historic lows, et cetera. And so the surest path to get stock prices higher and valuations higher is for companies themselves to be the buyers of their own stock, funded out of free cash flow.
So no consolidation. You don't push for consolidation, are you? Do you think there's buyers out there of Canadian assets?
We're pro M&A. We're pro our holdings doing acquisitions, so long as it results in one thing, and that is us getting paid more, faster, going forward. So a Crescent Point, they did a deal. It means that we're going to get paid 11% more next year than we would have on a per-share basis. Baytex did a deal, accretive by 17%. They're going to pay us 17% more than they would have before. So we're fine with that, especially when there's no massive overhangs. So that's generally the conversation, very, very jovial, but forceful, friendly conversation that we have with our holdings is we as an industry have to pursue this path. We have to become the buyers of our own stock, fund out of free cash flow, until people realize just how unbelievable these businesses are, even at $80 oil.
Eric,